You're so quiet, not a bloody word. Mark, well done. That was really great. This is your debut here in... there we are.
Under 21 minutes.
Very good. Excellent timing.
Thank you.
So, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, Mark was not correctly identified. He's the global head of music, but he's also the global head of all digital at WME, which those of you who don't know is William Morris Endeavor, who recently just invested $2 billion in buying IMG, the big sports and event company. So give him another big hand. That's hard work to do all of that. So now, this is where we get really exciting, and for those of you that are revolutionaries in the audience, and we hope that you all are because this is a revolutionary, we have evolutionaries. We'd like to bring onto the stage the CEO of the leading French independent, Emmanuel de Buretel, the CEO of Because Music. Emmanuel, give him a big hand. Bonjour. Bonsoir. And then, in addition, we are pleased to bring in somebody who is another real evolutionary and revolutionary, the founder and CEO of K7 Music and K7 Records, Horst Weidenmüller. Horst. Welcome, mein Freund.
I feel like a pop star already.
You are a pop star. We are all pop stars. So, guys, here we are. Interesting grouping. Some interesting stuff. Mark, you really set the thinking and set the cat amongst the pigeons, sort of. Emmanuel, you were watching backstage. You saw some of the things that Mark was doing. And just having a look at what you feel the future is, if we're trying to see really what the future is going to be, what are some of the observations you made about what Mark had said?
First, I think something was missing. The sponsor, Google, was missing from this presentation because it was mainly act on the streamers. And I think he didn't talk too much about the creators and the artist developers.
That's a good point, and we're going to really dig deep into that, because without the creators, something terrible happens. Nothing. Correct? That's Chris Blackwell, the famous founder of Island Records, always used to say. The first thing I wanted to, just looking at yourself, you have been responsible for developing some really incredible things. Going back to 2004, when you had your first hit at Because with Amadou and Mariam, the really substantial hit. Three big acts that you're working on or trying to make big at the moment is Metronomy, Justice, and Django Django. And you've really applied some really unusual ways in which you develop talent. For example, your Ed Banger event and also your online event. Just give us a little sample of some of your approach to that.
No, but right before, to come back to what Mark was saying, I used to work for a record company where in 10, 11 years ago, running Europe, I had some bosses who pushed me to put stickers with FBI logo on it and talking to me about Bon Jovi instead of the artist I was trying to develop called Daft Punk, Guetta, M83 or Phoenix. And these people were pushing me to put big stickers on Manu Chao CDs and I agree with him. Most of these people have disappeared from the music business, I hope, but they didn't have any vision, okay? And the big problem of the music business, you know, who forgot the history they forgot the history and they don't have vision, you know? And so it's our mistakes, you know? And today we run by the technological innovation. And it's why when I left, I decided to create a company called Because. But you know, instead of call it because.com, you know, it's because.tv. So from the beginnings, means 7, 8, 9 years ago, I decided my company will be a broadcaster. You know, will be on stream. So
social broadcaster.
Yeah, TV means, you know, it's an awful name, but he explained that you know, and my image department is bigger than my sound department, you know, and because most of the artists I sign, like Justice or like Metronomy, they have a very, very strong opinion on the music they made, and I have to help them to develop everything around it and all the audiovisual around it. And I got, you know, by focusing on this artist, we were quite successful, you know, and I'm still thinking that most of these actors of today don't treat the creators, and I will not call it the content providers anymore, but the creators.
Exactly. Good point.
Well, because, you know, content provider is your cat peeing on a video of 2 minutes with or any kinds of bad videos, you know, who makes a lot of people are watching them, you know, it's always funny. But you can't compare this with the job we're doing, you know, and artist development is a very difficult job today.
Extremely
much good. More technologic, you know, you have to be, you know, I was an engineer, and when I decided to go into music, you know, I really make my parents very sad, you know, because I was forgetting all my background. But today I can use my background as an engineer to do my job as a music man, you know, and I really enjoy it. You know, you have to be extremely good in optimization of networks, in you have to know how to deal with downloads, you have to know how to stream, you have to know how to still sell records, and even now go back to vinyl and do nice packaging, you know, because nice packaging and nice vinyl, you know, you can still sell 30 to 100,000 vinyl. You know, I think the figures on Daft Punk vinyl for Sony are incredible.
Huge. So your MIT background obviously helped you in that regard. You set up a publishing company in 2005. You even buy venues. You own La Cigale and Le Boule Noir.
At the beginning, you know, I think in same time I create a company called .tv, I believe in rights. You know, the future will be rights collection. And the model,
right.
The free model, you know, because we're going to a free model, the free streaming model, even though people will pay $10 a year or $15 a year, at the end, the user thinks it's free. You know, he doesn't remember he's paying. And so copyrights and the way to, you know, we used to have royalty system on CDs. Now we have track by track royalty system. So you have to search every song everywhere. You know, one day you will have a search engine checking all the UGC and all your track or bit of track used all over the net. So it's being a publisher helps today. You know, 20 years ago, being a publisher, if you were a bad record executive, they give you some publishing job to get rid of you. You know, today being a publisher helps you a lot to learn how to manage rights, you know, and the future is management of rights. And you know, you know, everybody who's talking about artists being able to manage themselves, how could you ask an artist to have a career in the same time thinking about managing his right at a level where the management of rights is today, you know, it's extremely difficult, extremely sophisticated. And that's the role of a music company and not a record company to know
Absolutely.
How to manage it, how to optimize it, how to decide to create, like all the independent create Merlin, to be together, to be able to optimize the management and face the big major bad deals with all these Googles and Spotify, where they take big advance or flat fee or shareholding. And because this big advance will not be recouped, so will not be split with the artist, you know,
right.
Rather than big percentage who establish, you know, the rules of splitting revenue with the future broadcaster.
So let's go to Horst. Horst, you started K7.
Yes.
How many of you here in the audience are familiar with K7?
So, 85. 85
but
21 years, yeah.
And the reason you called it K7 was that Kaiserdamm was the name of the street,
yeah.
And you were at number 7,
no, it was
right?
Just a notary meeting, and we couldn't decide how to do. We were arguing how to call the company,
right.
And we really had to go to the notary meeting. And the only thing we came up about was, okay, let's use K7.
Address.
French believed it has something to do with videos and cassettes. So there's a lot of creative thinking, but it's actually a very stupid idea.
Well,
it's just the name of the street and the number of the house. So.
Exactly, better than calling it K9. But established it essentially as an electronic dance label.
Oh, it started as a video label.
As a video label.
Video label in the 80s, yeah.
Oh, that's because you were a video production company.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're just
okay.
Excited about live concerts and live experience, and we
yeah.
Started as a video label, yeah.
And then you really made a mark in 2003 with DJ Kicks.
Yes.
That whole compilation series where you basically took DJ mixes and made them available to the consumer, which really, in the whole world of EDM, was a real breakthrough from that standpoint. Berlin being...
I think the word EDM even didn't exist at that time.
Of course, it didn't exist, and you were really part of the tribe that created the global following for that. Basically now you're on the Merlin board, but you've come up with the notion that there are now about 4,000 labels.
Yeah, I think, Mark, you want someone to disagree with you? I disagree. So I think what the labels have done is probably one of the most innovative things. Because in the back, the heydays, I think it was very boring.
You're talking about the indie labels here?
No, the record labels, recording music sector. Everything we did is pressing CDs, pressing vinyls, and bringing them into the market. Everybody did the same. It's quite boring. I'm speaking about the of course, there was a creative element. So then the crisis came, and everybody puzzled, oh, how the fuck am I going to deal with that? And now we have 4,000 different labels in Europe, and most of them have a complete different business model. I mean, I was a record label, I'm now in management, in service. There are other labels who are very big in sync, others have a booking agency, and we created a complete robust sector, and we completely diversified. And there were people like, oh yes, the crisis is coming, and the music business has only a crisis because you're so unorganized, we have to get proper people in, and A&R stands for alcohol and restaurants and everything. These are all gone, you know, they're all gone. And now we have 4,000 labels here and have the most robust foundation to grow. And I think what we have to define is where a label starts. And I think there's something which really changed since I'm in the music business. When I started and somebody wanted to be on my label, I said, if you want to have access to market, give me your rights. With the rights, I had the risk and I had to invest. Now, there is no more a problem of access to market. And for that reason, people are saying, well, access to market is not the problem. I can get the expertise externally, blah, 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 blah. So who has the rights carries the risk. But for me, that's great. I can sleep much better because I don't have the risk. And if I take the risk, I even want more rights than before. I want more rights. I don't just do that for the records rights anymore, because if I really take the risk, I probably go into management, so I think it's
good.
And
what do you mean by taking the risk?
By just taking the marketing investment, giving the money to make everything rolling, you know, right. And that's the risk. I think it's good, you know, sometimes not to have the risk.
Where do we disagree?
You said labels are dying and labels are on the way out.
No, I don't think you said that.
Oh, I'm sorry, then I'm officially apologizing.
It's okay. You don't have to be official. No, what I was saying was, you're right, Darwinism, when people make less money as a label and things got challenged, they diversified, right?
Yeah.
And you've done that brilliantly.
I know it's not only that. It's record companies. So record company is the past, music company is the future. Record company used to pay everything. They used to pay videos, they used to pay recording, they used to pay support tour, you know? But who was making the tour? The promoters. So promoters get the money from the... You know, it's an old model, you know, and when you look back, you know, you say, wow, you know, why they were paying support tour? Why? You know, the promoters were making the money. The agents who didn't put any money on the table were making the money. So the record company was very generous by doing that. You know why? Because in the past, you know, if you go in the 70s, Chris Blackwell, Virgin, they had agencies, they already had the tour inside, you know, and they were doing the tour because, you know, there was not a lot of money. Big vinyl sales was 100,000, 1 million, you know, so they had to organize the tour around the artist. You know, Blackwell was taking care of the Bob Marley tour, you know, and Virgin Agency, Steve Lewis, who became a big publisher for Virgin, was the head of the Virgin Agency. So they were making the tour. Then they were making so much money, that's right, there was a peak where the record company made a lot of money. You know, they abandon these kind of, you know, agencies and they focus on the recording and also on the publishing. And now we have to organize the tour. When you do artist development, you have to organize the tour, you know, because nobody's doing it. Don't tell me that big agency organize tour for very small artists. They say, what are you doing with the album? Do some promotion and then I take your band. You know, so we have to do it. So we have to have a touring company to organize the tour. And if it's successful, it's good for us, you know. It's not like the major company who do 360 deal where they take a portion of the money made by the tour, but they don't make the tour. They take a portion of the tour, they take the portion of the merchandising, but they don't really do it. They don't bring a more value in the business. I think independents like us, we had to do it, you know. And I think now even major companies are starting to do it. You know, in Europe, Warner, for example, has bought some big touring company to help them to make more money or to develop more bands.
So here's a question for the three of you. The OTT players, over-the-top players, Facebook, Google, YouTube, that's an imperfect system. We are reliant upon them to use that to get the music across, to get fan engagement at that particular level. But would one say that that is the issue that is broken? What's your view about whether we're getting effectively paid, you, as independent labels and as representatives of talent? You represent some major acts, just the Grammys, Pharrell Williams, number one, Gaga, etc. What's your view on the Google situation? For example, Facebook. Do you get paid by Facebook?
No.
Mark, what's your view on that?
View is that everybody, that we're still early in these big companies organizing their businesses. And as I said, once they're in the game and once they're generating dollars off our music, I believe version 4, 5, or 6, we will have a new economy where they are paying.
Which version are we on now?
0.01.
0.01, okay.
We're not even at version 1, right? And my premise was version 1 is when the players who have a lot of customers get in the game and launch.
Right.
And over time, just like YouTube launched their channels, what, a year or two ago? And they've already changed their model twice. They've already changed their philosophy twice. They've already changed how they pay people twice. It's an evolution. And I don't think software companies ever think they get something right on version 1.0. I don't think any technology company thinks they get anything right on version 1. In fact, version 1 is usually early adopter technology, and they get all the early adopters giving them lots of feedback, and then they do modifications and upgrades. And I think that happens in business as well. So it's a long way away from getting paid from the
Okay,
big
so we're
players.
Rolling the aircraft out of the hangar
yes.
onto the runway. What's your view on that, Emmanuel?
I agree with him, except that the approach is wrong. I think I like the model of Google, you know, even though we were suing on the past, you know, because I don't know if the history on the past, they pay the majors, you know, they pay the majors by buying their shares and, you know, from Google buying the shares of YouTube, the majors were inside YouTube, they pay the majors, who never pay the artists, but they never pay the indies, okay? They never pay the indies. So they start like, you know, they occupy territories, you know, and so the approach of occupying territories, I agree, I like revolution, you know, but sometimes when you occupy the territories and then make deals after, you always have, as a creator, a kind of frustration, you know. So for the first 5 years, they just occupy territories and you had to fight to get your video out, you know, because there was no real model, they were not paying us. And then when you sue them, they were so strong in terms of lobbying.
You mean they have greater resources than you would have to fight.
So you know they're really really big compared to us. But now they have a model. So we were in Europe, a lot of indies made deals with Google's and with YouTube and made money. But and in your presentation you say you start low but you go high, you know. But, you know, me, I can say it frankly. The negotiation with Google is not going high. You know, their model is going better. You know, they have competition now. You know, Beats and Deezer and Spotify. You know, they have a beautiful model. And we're investing a lot in that model. As I say, I have a lot of people. I have more people in my image department than in my sound department because I believe in creation of audiovisual. I believe in UGC. You know, I have people catching the UGC, and you know that's my role as a music company to chase. So I invest for them, and they make this big deal with the majors, as I say, where a lot of money goes. I don't know where it doesn't go to the artist, but they don't treat the indie who could represent 35, but perhaps with really good examination of perhaps we are much more than 35%, perhaps we're 40% or 50% at the end of the creation. It's difficult to know the figures. They don't treat us well, you know, because we're small, you know. And I think they have to consider the indie world as the world of the future, you know. And Mark told me,
You don't think that they do?
I gotta think. I don't think they know what an indie is. I don't think they know anything about this.
But they should.
Why do you think that? I don't think they're a music company.
They should be.
Last I checked, Google has a few products out in the market, and the worst one is a music product. So I think they do a lot of different things, whether it's Translate or Maps or Earth or obviously YouTube. And the amount of people that are focused on the music business inside Google, and some of them are here, okay, also at YouTube, they're good people, is infinitesimal relative to the company. The business of music and music paying is infinitesimal to the company. In fact, the ad revenue from music videos at YouTube, they gave away to Vivo, basically. Okay, so they didn't care about that either. My premise is just when you have people this big that you're trying to drag into your business, right? You can't expect them to understand who you are, how to differentiate you from a major. I think Steve Jobs got really pissed off with the labels for a long time and stopped dealing with them and then just froze them. Actually, in one of my speeches, I'll just say this now. I think Steve Jobs fucked over the music business so hard that the labels don't even know it. He was so angry with them for being arrogant and trying to tell them what to do, how to price it. I love music, I think we all do. I love Because, I love K7. Those are label identities. I grew up with 4AD, with Beggars, whatever it was, okay? If you go into any preference inside of view options, inside of iTunes or anything else, there's a field for last skipped. There's a field for last played. There's a field for how many kilohertz the song is. There is not a field for record label, okay? Steve Jobs purposely left record labels out. So when you get artist metadata information, it says Daft Punk, blah, blah, it doesn't say who the label is. Never did, because he was angry at them. And he actually stripped them of their identity, because the labels, understandably, went at him hard, and they wouldn't let him establish the business. And for me, the same thing's happening at the Google. And he got the labels back in a different way, which I think is somewhat identity destroying. And I grew up with label identities being almost as important, sometimes more important, than artist identities. So all of this version one negotiation, and Emmanuel's right, okay? He's right in an absolute way. The indies don't get treated like the majors. They don't get the advances. They're not this, that, and that. That, to me, all gets fixed in the future. The bigger problem is if they don't get in the game, they don't start these businesses, they don't convert users, we got a much worse problem to me, much worse. It's like electricity going down, all right? And all of this dies, and the rest of it stops. That doesn't mean labels aren't going to be successful. I think labels, if they do this, will be more successful than ever, be able to invest more, be able to spend more on artist development. And here's the other thing. I don't think Google, Apple, Facebook will ever be good at what you do. They don't know how. There's a purpose for people who find, support, and develop creators. And that is never going to go away, even when they said labels would be disintermediated. Not at all. Won't happen. Quite the opposite.
And this is at a time when more new acts are breaking.
For me, more new acts are breaking than ever. There's just not a good paying system in place.
Okay, Horst, what's your experience on this issue?
I mean, are we speaking about now YouTube or developing and creating revenue for young artists?
Both.
Both.
I don't even know if it's young artists. For me, I speak about overall payment systems. YouTube is one of those big players in the system, and they probably have, at some point, advertising that they are generating and contributing to the music economy, and at some point probably subscription.
I'm very concerned for YouTube entering the market, because for YouTube everything is about dominance, and dominance is connected to destruction. And I think we have a very healthy streaming business growing.
Definitely, and in Scandinavia.
And I would be surprised if Google is saying, "Oh, we come in at the same price level." For dominance purposes, they're probably coming in on a very price level, making problems to an established, to an emerging, healthy business. That's what I'm concerned about, that it's more about market dominance, complete 360 service to their customers of even giving music and everything, so they also know everything, and I'm more concerned than happy, and I'm at a point where I'm sometimes saying, I would rather prefer perhaps Google not being in music.
Well, their Google Music didn't exactly start off with a bang.
Oh.
Emmanuel, what's your view on neighboring rights? This is an issue that's starting to surface quite a lot, of course, in America. We don't have the same facility as one has in Europe. But do you think that neighboring rights and actively chasing for it, for example, independent publishers like Cobalt set up a special neighboring rights division to mine that area as an additional form of revenue. What do you think of that?
I think we organize in Europe to collect neighboring rights. So, you know, what Cobalt did is a way of, you know, going to the society like they do. You know, they don't have a presence on a country by country basis. They just collect direct from the copyright society. So neighboring rights is important. I wish they exist in the States, you know. I wish radios, you know, because radio, you know, the future will be a mix between, you know, streaming, radio is streaming, you know, and they don't pay any rights in the States, you know. You have Pandora who pay, you know, all the radio, FM radio doesn't pay, you know. It's like all this is very mixed today, and I think the future, if it looks like the music business, you know, is going to be free. In terms of the user, they're going to feel free. They're going to be able to listen to music with a very interactive way of but we have a big a bag which is full of holes where some people are not just not paying, and they use not to pay. But they pay some part of the world, they don't pay on other part of the world. You know, and I think he has to be, I don't know, the law has to be there to protect the creators.
So whose responsibility is it to pull all of this together? Is it Merlin acting as a unified force? Is it a collective of
but there, of Merlin is acting to put us together and to be able to help us dealing with the big group like perhaps Google or Spotify or you know, we did a good deal with Spotify by being together, but you know, the neighboring rights is more Obama's story, you know. Having radio to pay for music, you know, it's something. It's a revolution in America, you know. It's not a revolution in Europe.
I think there's a different revolution going on, right? Because now you're able to get 50% of certain types of advertising. You have radio going through IP. Take iHeartRadio, which is terrestrial radio, now going through an IP network, not paying. Yet Pandora is going through an IP network and is paying.
Yeah.
Right? So Tim Westergren's trying to do a lot of this work to say, hey, that's not fair that I'm paying and internet blog radio is paying and the big boy's not. I think that is one big significant change that has to happen and probably will happen because there's movements afoot to make it. But I think you said something that was interesting to me, which is music is or feels, and you used the word feels, free to the consumer. Right? I think what we saw was when music felt free, it scaled. Look at YouTube as an example. Okay, that feels free. Okay, even though we're watching ads, it feels free, right? And subscription at $10 a month or a data plan when we're using our phones feels free. But the truth is we're paying more than ever before. And every study in the world says if a consumer pays $10 a month, they're paying double what they ever paid in the history of music, yet it feels free and they consume more. So for me, if I just stay in my stupid lane of get consumers to pay $10 a month and offer it, and they feel good about it because it feels free and they're not having to pay per byte per song, okay? And it's like a monthly buffet, and the business gets healthier, that's a win-win. And to me, from a healthy platform of win-win financials, when the indies are not struggling as much and haven't gone through what they've had to do, morph their businesses, become promoters, agents, videographers, whatever it is, which, by the way, is all healthy, right? Because you're right, the industry should not be siloed. Artist development should come from a centralized vision, and hopefully those people have all the skills. But once there's a healthier economic base and people are not fighting over no money and investment money, I think the industry is good at renegotiating. And my history in this business for 30 plus years and your history is when you're in a position of strength, you renegotiate these deals. It's just what happens, whether it's with radio, whether it's with publishers, whether it's with Google and YouTube and Facebook and Apple and Amazon.
Except that now you have three major companies. One has almost 40% of the market, and his name is Universal. You know, Universal will, you know, as I say, me when I, you know, I always, you know, I have nothing against them. You know, they have great A&R, and it's a great company. But little by little, they're going to try to get 60% of the market and 70% of mine. And thinking 1984, you know, thinking it could be one company or two company controlling the music of the world, I don't think it's good for my kids.
I don't think that ever happens.
Do you think that's possible, Horst?
We're in a distributed world. I don't see how that happens.
We used to have a lot of major companies. Like, you know, at Midem 20 years ago, they were plenty of big company, Chrysalis, Island, Virgin, you know, and now we have two major and half, you know, and a lot of indies.
So if we have this problem with the OTT players, and we have what you've just articulated, surely the whole question of artist development, which is an issue that the OTT players don't focus on, that's the responsibility of whoever manages, owns, or supervises or superintends the talent.
Yeah, but you can have pop shit forever.
Does that mean we're living in a pop art era rather than true
art? But wait a minute, that's not
art?
What's been happening, though. There's more music of more types, and to Horace's point, I think more labels and more successful indie artists than there were before all this started.
That is true.
Certainly in where I live, whether you're on Bon Iver, whether you're Bon Iver or Sufjan Stevens or whoever it might be, there's more indie artists happening. In fact, your label, Because, has more success on Phoenix, on Daft Punk, than ever before, and you're not a major, and happening globally. Amazing. I don't agree with any of this, and I don't mean to take anybody on. I think that we've actually, what happened was, once the majors, no matter how many there were, lost control of radio because they couldn't control, lost control of distribution because they could no longer control on the internet, it gave rise to the indies and quality of music and consumers to actually say, hey, that's better than that pop shit than the majors are putting out. And it's actually happened all over the world. You're seeing an EDM explosion, sorry about the word, I know, of course, it's a pain in the ass for both of us.
I don't hate that word.
I do, but it's okay. But the point is, there's more stuff, more music of more types by more labels happening than it did before, when radio was controlled and retail was controlled and everything else was controlled. I think this is fantastic what's going on. I think the big problem that's going to come is all of those successes are going to take another hit.
Yeah, and it's about remuneration, because before we spoke about neighboring rights, and I think neighboring rights collection is something which is very disrupted at the moment, and that is because of concentration. I mean, we as Impala always said, if you're going to see all this, if you let these mergers through, there will become an economical point where these people are saying, for us it is better to collect neighboring rights directly instead of going through a collecting society. Fair enough. I think everybody would do that if they would be in the position of that business. But what it means for the remaining people who need to be in the collective system, it becomes really expensive, you know. And I think, and
there's, or there's a better system that they develop that you collect and you get more of your money. Could go either way.
Then you're dependent on them.
Could go, well, you depend on the collection societies now. And they're not very good, as you know.
No, but what it means now is like, if we, for instance, want to be one-to-one, because at the end of the day, it's money which filters to the artist, we cannot compete. If we earn less money, we cannot compete, you know?
Impala could set up a PRO if the labels go direct. You'll group yourselves like you do at Impala or AIM and do the same. The big change is actual accountability, because you know how the PROs... I think they got played this much.
No, but look, the Sony ATV deal with Pandora. You know, it destroyed the whole economy for the rest of the music.
You mean what
companies.
They're trying to do right now?
Yeah, but I think, you know, they because of market share, they get paid better.
That could go a bunch of different ways, including, by the way, the impact of that could depends on which way the courts go and how it all works. Get actual terrestrial stations to pay and be at parity. I don't know which way it's going to settle out. We'll see.
For the moment, it's not really going our way, you know. And I think the concentration, for me, I don't like the concentration, you know. And you know, it got stopped forever that Warner and EMI should have merged together. Finally, it's Universal who bought EMI, okay, and Sony ATV who bought EMI Publishing. So we got like the biggest publishing company and the biggest record company. You know, it's freaky. I think it's freaky.
And yet you're still working on breaking out. So you manage Tricky, you're developing Tricky, you signed this Bulgarian singer that started to break at South by Southwest last year, Dina. You got an album dropping on March the 3rd, Flash.
And I sleep much better.
You sleep better because of why?
Because for these two artists, I don't have the risk. I mean, with Tricky, we manage Tricky, and as a management company, we're also using our record company to develop him on a global level. Uh-huh. I think we can give him a very good service because we are not dependent on the revenue coming out of the record. We can also give sustainability to his career because he owns his master right, he owns his publishing right. We can invest more money into markets in order to develop his live market. And at night, it's not my risk, and Tricky makes more money because he's enhancing his market value. On Dina,
is that the same with that New Zealand seven-piece R&B group, Fat Freddy's Drop that you've got?
Yeah, but we don't manage them. We don't manage them. They're just straightforward. This is a typical act which could be on K7. You know, they're very well established. They're number one band in New Zealand. And, you know, and they don't need to give away the rights, but they need structure. They're exactly this kind of band who say, yeah, we would like to do it, but we have no infrastructure. So we provide them the complete infrastructure, and because we feel they are like-minded to us. Their music is our DNA, and we market it globally, and they're happy because they receive every month a check, which they never had before.
So at least we're agreed on one thing, and that is streaming is on its way. What we're seeing in Europe, certainly the Scandinavian model, streaming, no question about that.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's on its way. I might sit that one out.
Okay.
I think it still needs a big kick in the ass.
But it's waking up.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think as file downloads. I think in Europe, for Emmanuel, who's been watching Deezer and Spotify in Scandinavia, it's farther ahead than I would say it is. But either, look, that's subjective. I think it's sluggish, it's asleep, the big players aren't in the game. Beats, which is the first what I would call supplier-led promoters, are just
Do you think the public are going to want to go for curated streaming?
Curated, I'm sorry.
Do you think like
Beats? What's curated? Curated. I thought you meant Q, like Q-score.
Q-rated.
You scared me. I think part of the public will. Sorry about that one, Ralph. I think part of the public will. For me, I'm a bit of a playlist maker. I think if you're a power user, you're more comfortable with search, and I think the Pandora user and the Songza user, Beats, could go at them with much more functionality. Let's see. This is still version 0.7. This is like talking about GeoCities and social. When it was called community and bulletin boards. I don't think anybody in this room remembers GeoCities. If you do, I'm impressed. But that was the first, you know, billion or whatever it was, tens of millions of people who were posting and doing what today is known as social. And I don't know what these companies are yet.
Beats did a deal with Merlin very quickly, you know, and it looks like everybody's is waiting for Beats in Europe. And, you know, Deezer and Spotify, the relationship with the company is good, you know. I think Google, the relationship is good. We're working hard. We believe in the vision, but we just want more respect and more. We need, you know, I think most of the label in Europe, I don't know, and I'm sure in the States, have huge economic problems, and they need to be, you know, I think Google has to look at it. You know, if they lose the indie, they will get at the end two major companies they will have to deal with.
But surely, if you look back at the history of the business, it's the revolutionary indies that keep up the flow, keep up the energy. Artists want to be with them. Look at your situation. You're not taking the risk. The artist's got all the rights. You're working with your talent very closely. You can provide a whole rainbow of stuff to really get them developed. Isn't it ultimately down to the original linkage that drove some of the best record companies in the world?
Music
companies, absolutely. Who has the creative relationship with the talent?
Yeah, but it's about remuneration. I mean, you just use two examples where we have not the new remuneration, you know. It's about put us on equal terms which other players in the market get. That's why we created Merlin, and even Merlin doesn't get equal valuation. And we doing the investment, you're right. We doing the investment. We bring the new artists to market, either the managers or whatever. We bring the new artists to market. And as creators, we have to at least have the same remuneration, and that's
absolutely
the key
right problem.
People still believe the indies are an unorganized bunch of creative people who are happy with the crumbs, at least they can bring the music in the market.
I think it's a temporary condition. I understand the lack of respect. I think it sucks, and I agree with you guys, but I think over time, retailers paid the same for an indie record that they did for a major in wholesale cost, and it all was even. And I think the same thing is going to happen in the digital world. I understand today, if you take a snapshot today, we get 10 points less than a major. That sucks. Our music's great. We're in. Totally agree. I don't think that's the way it's going to work out.
I really don't agree.
You should talk to
Deezer right now about the pressure they have from Sony ATV, saying now we're too big for not to having a better deal.
To me,
market share will be important in the deals.
I understand. And to me, they are snowplows that are establishing new levels of the deals to which the indies are going to rise to. You may not buy that, but I think that's historical.
Anyway, okay. My message is Google should work with the indies.
They should absolutely work with the indies. Okay, so it feels like we're at 1789. on the streets of Paris at the barricades. What do we need to do to get Google and YouTube, or should I say Facebook, what can
Apple?
We do collectively?
Apple, Amazon.
Apple. There are a lot of them. So what do? We can't sit here and say, oh, hopefully something is going to work. What can we do that's concrete?
Competition is good.
Competition, so the EU competition law might help us in Europe. But what can we do collectively as a creative force?
Stop fighting, number one. Stop fighting. Stop arguing over the money now. Get it out the gate, fix it later. I know people don't trust that. I think that's the way it's always worked.
How about you guys?
Merlin is a perfect symbol of an organization who has been created by Indie and who's going to defend the Indie rights, and we're going to represent a share where we'll be able to compete with the majors.
So I think we did exactly the same right thing. The reason why we created Merlin was for that situation.
How many years ago was that created?
6 years ago.
Uh-huh.
But the problem is that still companies coming to market of saying, oh yeah, there are actually the majors you have to pay, and then there are the Indies, you can give them crumbs. And that's a problem. That's more a problem for the people because we just don't license to them.
I agree.
And that's a problem. I think, and there are more and more companies which are recognizing the value of the Indies of saying it's music. It has the same value as all the music. And these companies going to market, and other companies don't go to market because they don't respect the Indies.
I think it's all a negotiation. I don't think people want to launch without your content. I don't think they want to run their services without your content. I don't believe that that is what people from technology backgrounds who want complete libraries, who understand search and getting complete results, all right, are like. I think it's a negotiation. And I think you guys are both feeling like mistreated stepchildren, which I understand. I think it all gets worked out and everybody gets paid pretty much the same way.
So the question
is... But we'll see.
Right? We'll see.
The question is how we accelerate the negotiation, assuming that it'll work, in all territories with unity and unification amongst the creative community.
Hang on, I have one thing to say. He said, they both talked about consolidation, okay, and what happened, two majors, three majors. All right. I didn't want to talk about the core business I'm in, which is live music business.
Yeah.
But last I checked, that got consolidated. Two companies. Live Nation,
that's
AEG.
True, actually.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I have to operate in a two-company world. Now, there are more companies and more promoters, and by the way, you promote, and you know what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. But they're indies. There's two big companies. And my skill is, they got a lot of shelf space. Just like Spotify or iTunes. My skill is, I better get our artists on their shelf space. And if I fight with them, they're going to crush me. So I better be a good supplier. And to me, that's the same message that I'm giving up here. Regardless. And you know what? I don't know who pays more for who than what and whatever. Obviously, in my business, much more variable than in your business. But the point was to get Live Nation healthy. Because if I want more from them, if I want better deal terms from them, if I want them to invest, they're not going to do it when their stock price is 7, they're carrying $4 billion worth of debt, they're seen to be going out of business, and blah, 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 blah. When their stock's at 21, they're flush, they're getting profitable, their shit's coming together, their technology investments are starting to get rationalized, electronic ticketing, it's coming, and I need that extra $3 million for whatever it is, all right? That's a better time. Now, the problem for what I'm hearing up here is that when there's a deal to be done with YouTube, Google, or Apple, we're not making a deal against their hardware revenue, against their paid search revenue. It's making a deal in a silo of revenue that doesn't exist yet in streaming. Mm-hmm. And it's very, very difficult for people, I think. I don't think it's fair, by the way, so I'm not condoning 75 here and 60 here. But I do think it's very difficult for big companies that are staffing up, spending money in any infrastructure or technology, all right, to negotiate flexibly. And to even be smart about it. I don't even think they know what their business is yet. I don't think they know how they're going to ramp users and how much acquisition costs they're going to have to make and how much they have to use the rest of their network, which, you know, takes their ad inventory down.
But there is a market on streaming now.
But Mark,
now there is
I think the market's this big.
But Mark, but that would mean that it doesn't work with the indies. So look at Beats. They go into market completely with the indies. Look, Spotify goes into the market. Indies have a big share. It's not that. It doesn't work with the indies. There's good examples, but it always is how you treat the independents.
I think these people are not right. I'm not condoning it. I'm with you on that.
And I mean, on support, I mean, if you're saying I need to supply the shop, the shelf space, you at least want to get equally paid, and that is what comes onto the shelf space. And if somebody would tell you I only give you 50%, you probably put it not on
there. You're right. Here's my problem. For 15 to 20 years, I've been listening to fights about money. and everything got fucked. That's what I've heard, between the publishers and the labels. No, the publishers want to get paid on streams and downloads, and they want 25% because they were ripped off by the labels. They were only getting 12.5, whatever, okay? I have sat here as sometimes a participant, sometimes running a label, sometimes running a .com, or running a music side of an agency, and I hear the same shit over and over and over, and it's the same thing. It's fighting for the dollars before the market exists, one, okay? I believe every time markets are made, labels and publishers who are expert negotiators as well as signers, filters, mm-hmm. and developers, all right, yeah. figure out how to get their piece. I get it. And if Merlin sits, and that's become a topic of conversation on the sides, and goes, not until, A, two things are going to happen. Either the big players are going to launch without your content, and it's going to be shitty because it's going to be without your content, or they're going to make a deal with you, right? One of the two things is going to happen. All I'm speaking to is the speed of it happening. Because there's a bigger train wreck coming. I get the argument. And you know what? I hope Beats scales and I hope Spotify scales, but I don't think streaming is anywhere close to where it needs to be. I think there's what? Ralph, how many paying customers? Paying, rough, between all of them, in
you
your opinion.
Globally,
in a Spotify type access model.
Probably not more than 15 million worldwide.
Paying.
Worldwide.
Okay, 15. What does it probably have to be to make a dent? 100 to 500?
Yeah.
Okay, we got a long way to go. I could give a fuck.
We got a long way to go. And we also are dealing with people, however, in the OTT companies who really need to get the same kind of thinking that you find in the two main concert companies that you do.
And by the way, 5 million users to them is a stiff.
That's right.
Right? I mean, that's like, you're kidding. 5 million users? I mean, I don't even know what Google Play has, a lot less than that. But the point is, these people think in hundreds of millions. They think about converting everybody. So do the telcos. That's where we got to get to. That's when the money becomes just not an issue and we can get back to kind of being creative.
I'm frustrated because I can't... I like the revolution. I want to support you at the on the street, at the barricades. And what I'm trying to work out is, does the revolution go through the green light? Is the revolution stopped? Is this the Ukraine or is this Prague? Where the fuck are we?
I think we're at the point where we have to figure out how to get Apple, YouTube, Google, Amazon, and everybody else big into getting into the music business and working to version 2, 3, 4, and 5. Because if we don't, it's a bigger problem than we're talking about by 10 times over. End of story. I'm sorry, that part much I know.
Okay, final comments from yourselves on this.
Oh, I said Tommy is a question.
From my experience, I can say is if a new player comes into market, and he's engaging with all players at the same time, most of the time, the deals are happening very quickly.
Right.
If a player comes into the market and feels that there are three companies which are more important than the other body, which represents 10,000, then it becomes problematic. And that's about pace, and that's about dynamic. And I think what I would like to see, and that is what we have many good examples for it, is players coming into the market and recognizing the value and the service of independent repertoire, and with them everything works fine. And I just hope that this is going to be recognized in the future, because then we will have more services, bigger services, and a fastly growing streaming market.
Manuel, final point.
I think the more you suffer, the more you grow, and you learn from your mistakes. I think we made a lot of mistakes in the music business. We suffer a lot, but we're getting better.
We are
extremely sophisticated in our knowledge of growing our business and developing and being technical and being efficient. I think the independents used not to talk to each other, and now all together on a worldwide basis. You know, we have a lot of organizations like Merlin, Wynn, Impala, A2M, AM, and so we are getting organized to defend the independents and to be strong. And I think, you know, my dream is in 5 to 10 years to have the independent reaching a market share of 50%, which I think we have.
Quite feasible.
I think the majors are like dinosaurs. They didn't restructure. They're old fashioned. They have some, you know, we are into artist development. We'll, you know, and if we get well organized, we'll be able to defend our rights and succeed to grow.
So we have some unanimity, but some equanimity. And to close off, we're going to show a video. I'm pleased to say that someone got Barack Obama to actually perform something that this man here originally developed when he signed Daft Punk.
I published it.
You published Daft Punk?
No, I hope you pay the rights.
Well, that's funnily enough, we're going to show this, but it also is, frankly, ladies and gentlemen, us paying a tribute to Emmanuel, because the big success story of the last 12 months, of course, was Daft Punk. He was the one that really engineered it, developed it right from the very beginning. How long ago was that you signed the act?
It was not 2000.
So the wheel of progress turns slowly, the wheel of negotiation turns slowly. Ladies and gentlemen, from what Mark did, a fantastic presentation to show where the revolution is headed and how we get there is also up to you. So please, a very big warm round of applause for Horst, for Emmanuel, and for Mark.